All right, we are streaming live. I'm going to set myself to speaker view. And welcome, everyone. My name is Ryan Lynn. I am the Climate and Clean Energy Advocate with Environment Florida. I'm sorry if I'm looking to the side, I do have a couple notes. But Environment Florida, we are a statewide, citizen-based nonprofit dedicated to protecting clean air, clean water, and open spaces. Tonight, I'm excited that all of you are joining us for a special guest lecture. In the past, this week, we're partnering with Environment America's Our Amazing Oceans webinar series to talk about seagrass, mangroves, and how they interact with climate change, and learn all of that from Dr. Jim Forquin. So before we get started, I do want to note that this morning there was a really exciting event that happened. The House Democrats released their Select Committee on Climate Crisis report, highlighting some bold solutions that we can take to handle the bold problem of climate change. And I want to thank Congresswoman Kathy Castor for her leadership on that. I think we'll find that some of the things we talk about tonight go along with some of the things that she's outlined for our oceans conservation and battling climate change in general. So wanted to note that. Couple logistics. All of our guests are tuned in as guests, which means you have your cameras and your audio turned off. We have a Q&A box at the bottom and a chat box. So if you have questions at any time, please feel free to fill those in. We can answer them as we go, or we can definitely get to them at the Q&A at the end. But like I said, tonight we are going to hear from Dr. Jim Forquin about seagrass, mangroves, and climate. And as a clean energy advocate from the Midwest, moving to Florida, I've had a lot to learn about our coastal ecosystems, which is why I've enlisted some experts. So a little bit more about our guest lecturer. Dr. Forquin is a marine and estuarine ecologist with a special interest in benthic plant communities and nutrient biogeochemistry. He's received several degrees from the University of Virginia and completed a postdoctoral fellowship at San Francisco State University. Recently, he was elected to serve as the president of the Coastal and Estuarine Research Federation, which is the world's largest association of scientists and resource managers whose work concentrates on coastal environments. And currently, Dr. Forquin works as a professor and of biological sciences and the director of the Center for Coastal Oceans Research at Florida International University, which is based in Miami, and has taught there since 1993. He and his students address many aspects of ecological and biogeochemical processes in coastal plant communities, including carbon and nutrient cycling, plant-plant interactions, plant-animal interactions, and the structure of food webs. His laboratory, the Seagrass Ecosystems Research Laboratory, has exclusively used seagrass ecosystems as models for addressing general ecological questions. So we do have the expert here tonight. And I'm happy to say over the past 10 years, Dr. Forquin has also played a role in helping translate a lot of this science into actionable policy around climate change, which is definitely a huge goal for a lot of the work that we do. So with that being said, I want to thank everyone for being here, and I want to pass the torch over to Dr. Forkman. It's all yours.
Thank you, Ryan. So am I broadcasting now? You
You
can hear
are,
me?
yeah, you're good to go.
Great, thanks. Hey, I'm actually really happy you guys called and asked me to do this. Anytime I get a chance to help try to educate voters and policy and people on science and how it's important for policy, I jump at the chance. I also, though, really would hate to just stare into this blank eyeball that I'm looking at right now and talk either under you, through you, or past you. So I'd really appreciate, Ryan, if you could help me watch the chat box and watch the Q&A box. And please interrupt me, ask me questions as we go. Tell me if I'm off base on the marks that I'm hitting, because really, I know way less about you than you know about me after Ryan's introduction. So let me try to figure out again how to use my screen share. And yeah, it's a death by PowerPoint. I'm sorry. And if I share this, you all can see one of my students from long ago swimming through a seagrass bed, correct?
Yeah, it looks good.
All right. So grass, groves, and global warming. What I want to do today is talk to you about seagrasses and mangroves, just a little bit about mangroves, actually, what seagrasses are, because I find that most people, just a second. Stop the pot, please. Sorry, the hazards of working from home. Many people don't really quite know what seagrasses are, so I figure I'll start off with a quick introduction about the biology of seagrasses and then talk about their role in carbon cycling and the carbon that's stored in them and the way that we think they can be used as tools for climate change mitigation. Yeah, that didn't work. Sorry, this did work a second ago. Ah, there we go. All right, so seagrasses aren't seaweeds. Seagrasses are flowering plants that are returned to the sea. And this is, you're looking at turtle grass. I think you can see my pointer, right? So they're flowering plants. This is a male seagrass flower. This is a thalassia or turtle grass. And there are different male and female plants. So that's a male flower. And that's a female flower of the same species. And seagrasses are a really kind of small group of plants. And seagrasses are not they're ecological group, not a taxonomic unit. What I mean by that is there wasn't one seagrass that then speciated and created all the seagrass species we have today. Instead, there were multiple lineages that came from different plant groups that readapted to life underwater in the ocean. So like mangroves, which are just a group of trees that grow in salt water, seagrasses are really just a group of flowering plants that grow under the ocean. And we'll call a plant a seagrass if it grows fully submerged, if it's anchored by roots, if it's adapted to live in salt water, it has flowers that are pollinated underwater and can compete with other organisms in the sea. But there's been a long history of confusion about the difference between seagrasses and seaweeds. The Greeks, of course, said seagrasses were just a type of seaweed. They weren't paying much attention to genetics and phylogenies back then. But much later than the Greeks, the first book that was published about seagrass biology was published in the 1970s. And so this is the Handbook of Seagrass Biology. The editors, Ron Phillips and Peter McCroy put the book together, and then they sent it off to the publisher. And when the publisher wrote back and said, hey, we really need a dust jacket and a photo, you mind if we put some art on it? They said, oh, no, that's no problem at all. So the publishers came up with this dust jacket picture that's all seaweeds that went on the first book of seagrass biology. So here's the difference. If you look at this bottom picture here, if this is an evolutionary tree, about a billion years ago, the algaes split off from the things that would lead to the ferns, the cone-bearing trees, the pine trees, dicots and monocots. Dicots and monocots is about 100 million years ago where they split off, that's here. And then early on in the evolution of monocots, the groups that gave rise to the seagrasses split off. So there's really about a billion years of evolution difference between the seaweeds and the seagrasses. And there just really aren't that very many of them. And they don't all look like grass. So this is just some pictures to show you some seagrasses from Florida and beyond. This is called manatee grass. It looks way more like spinach pasta than it does grass. It's got these cylindrical leaves. This is a much more grass looking thing, these strap-like leaves. This is Posidonia oceanica, and this is about 110 feet deep in the Mediterranean Sea. Some of the grasses have a very non-grass-like, some seagrasses have a very non-grass-like look. This is a Halophila species growing on the bottom of Shark Bay in Western Australia, where I've got to do a lot of work. Some of the seagrasses look like bushes. So this is a kind of a more woody, high standing, maybe 3 feet tall, bushland underwater. This is Amphibolus antarctica, also in Australia. And then some of the seagrasses are very, very tiny and hard to see. And this one is actually found all around the world. It's called Halophila decipiens. So there's that group. And the life cycle looks something like this. There are seeds that sprout. Those seeds differentiate into big plants. Some of those plants are males and some of them are females. The males make male flowers. The female make female flowers. Those flowers produce pollen. The males that produce pollen that finds female flowers, they develop into fruit. Then that fruit opens up and redisperses the seeds. And this one, Thalassia, is the most common one in Florida. And it's actually ovoviviparous, which means before the seeds leave the flower, they've sprouted. So you see this seed here has leaves on it already. So it's actually a seedling by the time it comes off of its parent. Seagrasses are abundant in tropical and temperate regions. There's little black dots all over this. I'm not sure how well they show up for you, but there are seagrasses in the North Slope of Alaska and in Europe and in Japan and the Kamchatka Peninsula and then all around, you know, all through the tropics, and they reach down into the pretty southerly waters as well. So they unlike the mangroves, which I'll touch on today as well, they're temperate and tropical when the mangroves are just tropical. And sorry for the spaghetti diagram. The reason we care about seagrasses are these things in these green boxes. Seagrasses protect our coastal environments and our coastal cities from erosion and storms. They provide really critical habitat for protected species. They really increase biodiversity. There's a lot of stuff that lives in seagrasses. They're a very important natural filter and really do a great job of regulating nutrient availability and plankton blooms in our coastal environments. They increase our ecosystem resilience to disturbance, and they sequester carbon. So that's the reason that people should care about seagrasses. Just some pictures, some pretty pictures. These are manatees in Puerto Rico in a turtle grass meadow. Here's a sea turtle in Mexico, also in a turtle grass meadow. So seagrasses are critical food sources in tropical regions. They provide critical habitat in both temperate and tropical regions for both endangered species like this seahorse or charismatic species like the zebrafish in Western Australia. There are really valuable fisheries resources that are based from seagrasses as well. There are a lot of things like spotted sea trout in the Gulf of Mexico, pink shrimp, queen conch, spiny lobsters, as well as things like cuttlefish, which we don't have a whole lot of in Florida. But there's somewhere between $3,000 and $5,000 per hectare of fisheries value comes out of most seagrasses. The big number, if you want to generate the value of the economic goods and services produced by seagrasses, the big thing, though, is the fact that they absorb and transform nutrients. So our waste products that we release into the coastal ocean are transformed into things that will no longer lead to nutrient problems and algae blooms by this biogeochemical reactor that seagrasses are. And they're also sediment stabilizers. So they hold that sediment in place so it doesn't move around. It prevents resuspension, it prevents erosion, and they protect the built environment that's on shore from them. Now, they have this root system that really is great at holding sand and keeping it from moving around.
We do have a question if you would like.
Okay, sure, please. So
Mateo asked, being that they are aquatic angiosperms, mm-hmm. Does seagrass feature double fertilization like terrestrial angiosperms? Is there much of a difference between marine and freshwater seagrasses like the natural springs in Florida?
All right, so to be a seagrass, you have to be in marine water. So remember, these are definitions that were created when we lumped groups of organisms together. So Vallisneria is a very common thing that looks just like a seagrass, but it occurs in the springs in North Florida. So they're both rooted vascular plants that grow submerged, but only the seagrasses are considered seagrasses, only the ones that live in the sea. But other than that, they perform the same ecological function, whether they're seagrasses or vascular aquatic plants or submerged aquatic plants. Now, double fertilization, I'm not enough of a botanist to understand that, but so there are many different evolutionary origins of seagrass, and therefore there are many different mating systems. Some of them are monoecious, meaning males and females in the same organism. Some of them are dioecious, where they're separate males and females, but they are pollinated by pollen that is produced by one flower and ideally moves to another flower. Some of them can self. So Zostera, which is really common in Virginia, can actually self-fertilize. But in general, mating systems are designed to maximize outcrossing or to prevent selfing. Mateo, did that answer the question?
Yes.
Okay, thanks. So seagrasses, they need really clear water. And because they need clear water, the reason they need clear water is because their roots are down in this mud and the mud doesn't have any oxygen in it. So they have to produce oxygen in order to get it down to the roots to prevent them from smothering. So seagrasses are kind of in a bad way with humans because a lot of our activities decrease water clarity. They need sandy or muddy bottoms, relatively stable salinities, moderate waves and currents. Now, humans and seagrasses basically don't get along very well because humans mess up with clear water. We often dredge sand. We change salinities and we, by dredging and filling and port activities, we change waves and currents. So I'll get back to the what's going on historically with seagrasses after I talk about their importance for carbon storage. So we have a broad variety of seagrass habitats. So here's South Florida. I'm actually sitting right here off the picture. This is Florida Bay, the Florida Keys, Big Pine Key for those of you who've been down there. So we have some seagrass meadows like up here in Northern Florida Bay that have very narrow leafed, very sparse seagrasses that are really limited by nutrient availability. Down just north of Long Key, we have very lush expanses of Syringodium filiforme or manatee grass. In the deep waters where nobody ever bothers going diving, if you get down there, you find that there are huge expanses, larger than the state of Connecticut actually, expanses of this Halophila species that just goes right by most people's notice. But then mostly in Florida, when people conjure up the image of a seagrass, they think of these turtle grass meadows with these strap-like leaves, kind of a nice dense carpet. And we have seagrasses in South Florida almost everywhere, except for where like rocky things grow out of the bottom, like corals. Seagrasses can't grow on top of corals because there's no sediment for them to root in. This is kind of a joke, but I don't think it's going over very well. If you were lucky or unlucky enough to be in my laboratory, you would have participated in making these maps. Each of these little tiny black dots is a place where we generated a random number and my students went out and swam. And we mapped the distribution of different seagrass species across South Florida. Second. And when you put all those together, we have about 18,000 square kilometers of seagrasses in just the Southern Florida region. There's about another 6,000 square kilometers up in the Big Bend closer to Tallahassee. But there's a lot of it. That 18,000 square kilometers is bigger than Connecticut and Rhode Island put together. Okay, so there's a lot of seagrass. It's really cool. Now let me get to this part about climate change. And we know that climate is changing. We know that the reason climate is changing is because people are putting more carbon dioxide into the atmosphere. And this is like the best, from the best science webpage you can get, go to the NOAA page and look up the Keeling curve. Back in the early 1960s, Keeling started measuring CO2 concentration in the atmosphere at the top of Mauna Loa. And this is just the 2016 to current data. And you can see the red line going up and down. Every winter, So every summer, CO2 concentrations go down in the Northern Hemisphere, and every winter, CO2 concentrations go up in the Northern Hemisphere as plants green up and die. But then there's this long-term trend, and that long-term trend has been going up for a long time. So this basically represents my lifetime. I'm getting to be an old guy now. But there's been a 30% increase in CO2 concentrations in the atmosphere just in my lifetime. And if you look further than that, this is CO2 concentrations going back about 1,000 years. There was relatively stable CO2 concentration in the atmosphere. There was this place where CO2 dipped down, and this is kind of a mini ice age. But early in the 1800s, CO2 concentrations started marching up, and then they really ramped up very rapidly. And now they're taking off even more rapidly. But if you take an even longer look back, CO2 concentrations, that's the solid line down here, 100 million years ago. These are basically when the seagrasses evolved, when they first appear in the fossil record. So time of the dinosaurs is right in here. So the time of the dinosaurs, CO2 concentrations are about 2,000 parts per million, as opposed to the close to 400 that they are right now. And you see that from 100 million years ago to 10 million years ago, CO2 decreased. And then from 10 million years ago to about 500,000 years ago, it continued to decrease and then stabilized. And this little tick up right here at the end is the historic increase in carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. And where did all that carbon dioxide go? Well, animals and plants died. Plants grew, it was warm, there was a lot of CO2, the plants settled to the bottom, was dead and buried and turned into organic material and sat there kind of out of the atmosphere for 100 million years. And then in the 1800s, we discovered that you can drill holes in the ground to get this stuff that burns really well out of the ground. So the production of fossil fuels really led to this huge increase of CO2 in the atmosphere. And why do we care? Well, of course, you all know that there's this greenhouse effect, that shortwave radiation from the sun comes in, it's absorbed and then re-emitted as a longer wavelength, and that longer wavelength is absorbed by CO2. And if the energy is being absorbed in the atmosphere, it gets warmer and warmer. So why be worried about a greenhouse? Isn't a greenhouse a good thing, right? We use greenhouses to grow basil, I think that's what this is, in cold climates. But greenhouses aren't always a good thing. So we know that it's getting warmer and warmer, and we also know that the ocean is getting more and more acidic as CO2 concentrations in the atmosphere increase, so that we can see changes of communities that are adapted to relatively low CO2 concentrations in the atmosphere and relatively low temperatures that change very rapidly as temperature changes and CO2 concentrations change and pH changes into places that aren't nearly as biodiverse or as interesting to look at as the things that they were replaced. So the CO2 that's going up into the atmosphere is mostly being driven, 85% of the increase in CO2 is coming from burning of fossil fuels, but about 15% roughly of the CO2 that we're putting in the atmosphere is not coming from burning fossil fuels, it's coming from converting carbon dense environments like forests into carbon sparse environments like pastures or cities. And so that's about 12% roughly of all of the CO2 that goes to the atmosphere is because of this land use, land cover change. And in recognition of that, and in recognition of the co-benefits of the conservation of these environments, of these high carbon environments like increases in biodiversity, the United Nations recognize that there's a value to trying to keep that carbon from going from high dense carbon environments to low dense carbon environments and therefore into the atmosphere. And there's a program that's developed called RED, which is the reducing emissions from deforestation and forest degradation. And it's an effort basically to pay people to prevent the conversion of land use to putting more CO2 into the atmosphere. And RED has been very successful, especially in developing economies, at changing the path of development. And behind all this is the idea that there's a value to that carbon. If we keep it out of the atmosphere, it's problems that we don't have to spend money on solving. So why don't we pay people to keep the carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere instead of putting it into it? So how much is CO2 worth really is an important question for determining whether there is an economic stability or an economic driver that can be used to stop land use land cover change and keep the carbon in the ground. So how much is CO2 worth? Well, its value fluctuates up and down on the futures markets based on governments and political driving. But you can see that after a long time of kicking around at about $5 or $10 per ton, carbon in the last couple of years has really started to increase in value, meaning that if you can buy a ton of carbon and keep it in the ground, you can sell that ton of carbon later on the carbon markets. And the higher the rate is, the more profit will be realized from that. And so I'm involved in an effort called the Blue Carbon Initiative, which is trying to make people aware that forests are not the only really high dense or high carbon density environments. Our coastal ecosystems like seagrasses, mangroves, and salt marshes are some of the most carbon dense places in the world that are being converted into carbon scarce environments at a very rapid rate. And there should be then value to these habitats, just like there's value to preserving forest habitat to keep CO2 out of the atmosphere. So mangroves, I said I'm going to say a little bit about mangroves. This is me, and I'm not a tiny guy. These are huge trees. It's obvious when you look at a mangrove forest that there's a lot of carbon there. There's carbon in the trees. There's carbon, this is a forest, just like any other forest. So of course, if you cut these things down and burn them, that carbon's going to go into the atmosphere. But a small fraction of the carbon in this ecosystem that you're looking at is actually above ground. Almost all of it is below ground in the mud that piles up in mangrove forests. And this is just a graph that's comparing the amount of carbon, the height of the bar is the amount of carbon in boreal, temperate, and tropical upland forests. So these are the rainforests of Brazil and the amount of carbon that's in them. You see that mangroves have a tremendous amount of tree carbon and really just huge amounts of mud. Organic mud that makes them the most carbon dense environments that we know of in the world. And land use and land cover change are driving the eradication of mangroves very, very rapidly. It's just an aerial view of one of the shrimp ponds. These are the reasons you can buy shrimp in Publix for $4 a pound. It's the unsustainable development of shrimp ponds, using them for a few years to generate tiger prawns is what this is. At huge cost. They plow the forest down, burn all of that carbon, putting it into the atmosphere, dredge up the bottom, pile up the soil. They dig these things out to about a meter deep, pile them up, and then all that CO2 goes in the atmosphere as well. So shrimp, farm-raised shrimp are probably the worst thing with the biggest carbon footprint you could ever eat. And so it's the community, the international community has accepted the idea that mangrove forests should be incredibly important for keeping carbon out of the atmosphere and under a red framework. But how important is seagrass carbon? We got a lot of seagrass in South Florida, in Florida in general. So most of the carbon, almost all of the carbon really in seagrasses is not here in the green stuff, it's down here in the soil. It's the organic matter that's stored in the soil below them. And we've gone, this is me in Saudi Arabia, and this is me in Australia. We've started over the last 5 years really inventorying the amount of carbon that's stored in the world's seagrasses. And when you dig a hole and measure the amount of carbon in them, these are just sites for Florida Bay, you can see if you go down the core, this is depth, and this is how deep you are down in the soil, there's carbon all the way down, and then some really big amounts of carbon that's stored down below. So in this case, this carbon down here was produced over 15,000 years ago. And I'm sorry, I said the wrong thing, 1500 years ago. So this is, 1,500 year old carbon that's been kept out of the atmosphere. And if we were to dig all this stuff up and plow it up, it would all go into the atmosphere. So there's carbon all the way down in seagrass soils. And if you look across the world and put all of this stuff together, we find that there are seagrasses with a little bit of carbon in them and seagrasses with a lot of carbon in them. So they're not all equal in their ability to store carbon. But when we compare them, this is the same plot I showed you earlier, boreal forests, high latitudes, temperate, tropical forests, mangroves, and seagrasses. You can see first that seagrasses has this little tiny green sliver compared to these larger gray, light gray slivers. That's very little living biomass, but a whole bunch of soil biomass. And these individual stars are the most carbon dense seagrasses in the world. These are actually in the Mediterranean, and then these are Florida Bay and Shark Bay down here. So especially the temperate, or the warm temperate and the tropical seagrasses have just as much carbon in them as any of the other habitats that are valued for their carbon storage potential.
Hey, we have a couple more questions.
Sure.
Yeah, seem to get a lot. So Morgan from Facebook is asking that, or saying that a lot of environmentalists value planting more trees. Is there a way to plant more seagrass and more mangroves?
Yeah. So let's deal with mangroves first. We know that sea level is coming up, and there are going to be more and more and more potential for conversion of things that are now uplands into mangroves. So that there are certainly lots of places you can plant mangroves, both in a restoration capacity, just to restore what was there. And mangroves actually are quite easy to plant. So there's potential to restore. There's also the potential to afforest or to create new forest if we leave space for mangroves as we're planning for sea level rise. Planting seagrasses is a different game, though, because usually we lose seagrasses because we've ruined the environment and there's not enough light. Remember, I said they need a lot of light. So you have to fix the environment before you can plant seagrasses. And there are a few places where seagrass transplanting has actually been a huge, huge success. And there are many places where seagrass transplanting hasn't really panned out. But yes, if we fix the environment, we can get more seagrasses. And there's a great example in Florida. In the late 1960s, early 1970s, the seagrasses in all of Tampa Bay disappeared because there was horrible handling of domestic sewage and wastewater. They recognized that this was a problem, and in the 70s began a multi-billion dollar effort to redo the entire waste handling system in the Tampa Bay area. And it took 40 years, but they cleaned up the water and seagrasses came back. So they hit their restoration targets about 5 years ago, but it took decades and decades of hard and dedicated work to do it. So yes, you can plant them.
Awesome. We do have a couple more questions actually about all of this as well. So Dawn from Facebook wants to know, do mangroves hold more carbon than peat?
Peat is basically soil that has really high carbon content. So we have mangroves and seagrass peats that have just as much carbon in them as other peatlands. And then there are peatlands that have way more carbon in them than seagrasses. So it's really a definition that's being driven by the definition of peat. Peat is a high carbon density, high organic carbon soil.
Okay, great. And Mateo, again, on our Zoom call wants to know, which species of mangroves do you work with? He's personally interested in working with black mangroves.
I've had students working on all of the mangroves we have in South Florida, including the invasive exotics that we have now in South Florida. So, it depends how you count mangroves. There are five or so species of mangroves that are common in the Caribbean, the New World tropics, and all of them have a place in the tidal frame so that they'd be important in restoration efforts. So Rhizophora, Abyssinia, Leguncularia, Lumnitzera, Conocarpus, so lots of them.
Very cool. Mateo also wants to know, are seagrass populations mostly decimated by population, or are there newer or volatile diseases that are more common due to climate change?
Yeah, one thing that this question, I'm gonna go off on a tangent and then I'll come back to the question. You remember I said seagrasses evolved 100 million years ago when carbon dioxide concentrations were many, many times higher, 8 times higher than they are now. Seagrasses stopped evolving really 75 million years ago when all that CO2 was sucked out of the atmosphere because carbon dioxide concentrations in the ocean got so low, so that seagrasses are actually limited by CO2 availability. So in the future, we think as long as we keep the water clear, there's going to be more seagrass because there's going to be more carbon. We have lost, I'm going to get to that actually in the next couple of slides, we've lost a tremendous proportion, at least 40%, probably more, of the seagrasses that existed at the beginning of the 20th century, largely because of degradation of water quality and poor waste treatment.
Yeah. That makes sense. We've got one more question right here. Mm-hmm. In what locations, this is from Rachel, in what locations were replanting seagrass successful and why?
All right, so Mateo asked this question about diseases. There was a disease, a suspected disease in the early part of the 20th century that took out a whole lot of the temperate seagrasses in the North Atlantic, the species called Zostera marina. And we called it the wasting disease in the 1930s. So it was coincident with increase in agriculture and decrease in water quality, but there appeared to be a disease. And that disease took out Zostera from North Carolina all the way around to Spain, all the way around the North Atlantic. And it took a long time for it to come back. And there are places where that Zostera never came back. And so when I was doing my dissertation work in the very latter part of the 20th century, the eastern shore of Virginia was considered to be a place where seagrasses wouldn't grow because there weren't any seagrasses there. But we knew there had been seagrasses there in the 1800s. And it turns out that the reason seagrasses weren't there was because there was dispersal limitation. Seeds just weren't getting there because there was a Chesapeake Bay population that seeds were transported to the south, and there were like Delaware Bay populations where seeds are getting transported to the north. But in the middle there, in the eastern shore of Virginia, there were just no seeds. So a plant showed up, and my colleagues at the University of Virginia found them and started documenting them. And then I have a colleague at the Virginia Institute of Marine Science who said, hey, the conditions may be, they must be great over there. So they started planting seeds from Chesapeake Bay over to the eastern shore of Virginia, and it's been tremendously successful. So they've generated a huge new seagrass meadow that had been missing for 200 years because the environment was right and it was just dispersal limited, no seeds.
Great. I actually did misread that question. What makes seagrasses unsuccessful in being replanted?
Well, there's a number of reasons that seagrass restoration is difficult. One is, in Florida anyway, we don't have species that are easily sown by seed. So what that means is you have to damage a bed in order to get the plants to plant in another place. And then the places that we're planting them out are generally places where the environment has been changed in a way that's deleterious to seagrasses. So until we fix the water clarity, we can't transplant seagrasses there. And when we do transplant seagrasses, it's transplanting. We're digging up at one place and planting them in another. So it's just different. It's difficult if the environment has been damaged to successfully reestablish the seagrasses.
Great. We have a couple more questions, but I want to see a little bit more if any of them are answered through the rest of your slides, and we'll definitely circle back.
Okay, great. So there's a lot of carbon in seagrasses. We think, but we don't really know. that there's somewhere between 300,000 and 600,000 kilometers of square kilometers of seagrass is still left in the world. And from that work I just went through really fast, we know that there's about 25 tons of carbon per, 2.5 tons, a megagram is a ton of carbon per hectare in living seagrass biomass. In the seagrass soil, though, there's 50 times that. There's about 150 tons of carbon per hectare. So if you add all that up over that 300,000 to 600,000 square kilometers, we know that seagrass soil, there's somewhere between 4.2 and 8.4 petagrams of carbon. And a petagram is a, make sure I get it right, yeah, a billion tons. So there's a tremendous amount of carbon that's stored. And that in seagrasses is just about equal to everything that's been stored in mangroves and in salt marshes combined, which is about 10 petagrams. So there's a lot of carbon out there. But we're losing seagrasses. We continue to lose them very, very rapidly. So this is just a picture from a paper that I helped write in PNAS a few years ago now, that basically the spots are, it's a literature review, and these are red are the reports in a location of seagrass declines, green is increases, and yellow is no change. And you can see that there are mostly declines being reported from around the world, even into the 21st century. And if you look at the rate of decline in the literature through time, what I want you to get from this is in the pre-1930s, and we come out to here, this is the 2000s. And as we get closer and closer to current time, the rates of loss are accelerating. So we're losing it very rapidly. And it's averaged 1.5% since the beginning of the 20th century, but it's in the recorded losses, it's up to like 4 or 5% per year loss that we're going on right now, which means we've lost about 11 to 22 teragrams of carbon per year of seagrass biomass, and somewhere approaching 300 million tons of carbon in that soil going into the atmosphere per year. So these are roughly 10% of the total CO2 fluxes that are attributable to all of that terrestrial land use land cover change that I said earlier makes up about 15% of the total amount of CO2 that's going into the atmosphere. So it's there's a lot of it, and seagrasses are disappearing quickly, and it's very valuable. So we bring back tidal marshes, mangroves, seagrasses. These are ecosystems. How much of that ecosystem we have, how fast we're losing them. And if we calculate how much that's costing us in ecological goods and services based on the societal cost of carbon of $41 a ton, which was what was being used by economists in 2012, the seagrass carbon that's being lost is worth somewhere between 2 and 14 billion US dollars per year. Mangroves are somewhere between 4 and 18 billion US dollars per year, and tidal marshes somewhere between a half and 10 billion dollars per year. So these ecosystems have a lot of carbon in them. The carbon is at risk of being put into the atmosphere. So at rates that are fast enough to make a difference to the CO2 concentrations of our atmosphere because we're losing them. And I thought I would end just with a picture of me underwater saying, I hope I've given you plenty of stuff to ask questions about.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. We do have lots of questions that have been coming in from Facebook and Zoom. One question that was asked early on, which I think is a more of a clarification, Don from Facebook wants to know, so seaweed was developed before seagrass.
Yeah, seaweeds have a really ancient evolutionary origin in the oceans. You know, a billion years ago, we got our first algae. So algae split off from the lineage that would lead to plants, you know, a billion years ago, 400 million or plus.
Awesome. So June is asking, if our coast gets hit by a hurricane, for example, like Hurricane Irma, how long did it take for seagrass to recover?
Yeah, so it's an interesting question because seagrass and mangroves are damaged by hurricanes, but they've evolved with hurricanes. So Irma, for example, when she crossed South Florida, caused very little measurable damage to seagrasses. If you look at it over the broad scale of South Florida, that 18,000 square kilometers, but there are individual little spots within that broad landscape where seagrasses were changed in a way that they'll never come back. But on the other hand, there are places that have got more sediment dumped on them that are likely now develop seagrasses that weren't seagrass before. I post a paper from a long-term monitoring program looking at the passage of George in the 90s across the Keys, which was a lot like Irma in the path it took and the damage that it wrought. And we had, depending on location, we had a couple of places that the seagrasses were lost and have never come back. We had a bunch of places where there was about a 50% loss of seagrass biomass, but then was all back the next year. And then even more places where there was no damage. So hurricanes are part of the fabric, and the disturbance that hurricanes bring in the long run isn't all that damaging to seagrasses or mangroves, but that's only if people don't get in there and mess up the recovery.
Okay, great. And Joyce is asking, how has plastics in our water and oceans affected seagrass?
Yeah, the microplastics problem is really a problem of contamination of the food web more than it is a problem for seagrasses or mangroves themselves. You know, if you go into a mangrove forest anywhere in the world, you find a tremendous amount of floating plastic, and that's pretty bad for all the animals that are in the mangroves. But sure, you can find negative impacts, but plastics don't really affect the plants that much. And in seagrasses, many of these plastics float, and it's only the real small particles that they end up in the seagrasses. So once again, it's a food web issue, not a damage to the plant issue for plastics.
That makes sense. Question from Jim, are marine invasive exotics as problematic as terrestrial invasives?
So there are examples of marine invasive exotics, and some of them are very problematic and some of them aren't. Right now there's an invasion of a Indian Ocean seagrass species that started in the French Islands in the Caribbean, and they're moving north. So probably in the next 10 or 20 years, we're going to have Halophila stipulacei growing in South Florida, displacing some of our native species. In South Florida, we also know that we had mangroves that were brought in here in the early part of the 20th century and planted in gardens from all over the world that have escaped. So those plants, one of them we'll never get rid of. There's a Lumnitzera in South Florida that will be part of our mangrove flora for the next few thousand years, I'm sure. There have been invasive algae species that have caused huge problems as well. Caulerpa taxifolia is one that comes to mind. And then there are, of course, the animals that ride along with the plants that can be an issue as well. Green crabs in the northern part of the Atlantic coast of the United States have really changed the structure of the food web almost completely, and they rode in on seaweeds, I think, that were brought in with oysters. So we do have examples of invasive exotics in the plant community. And then, of course, there's tons of animals that are problems.
Yeah. Julie wants to know, what would you say is the biggest threat that seagrass is currently facing, and how can we better protect seagrass?
Yeah, so seagrasses, the biggest threat is water clarity and water clarity degradation. And the way that we prevent that is by stormwater management, wastewater management, prevention of nutrients from getting into lakes and streams and then coming down to the ocean. Also now, the armoring of the coast is creating a problem for seagrasses and mangroves to respond to climate change. And so under a normal climate change scenario, without humans and cities being built all along the coastline, as sea level rose, these communities would just migrate into what is now inland. But we're preventing that now. So as waters get more turbid and deeper against seawalls, it's likely that we'll squeeze out the seagrasses that can't migrate anymore.
Great. Joy said that she has gone flats fishing in Biscayne Bay for about 15 years, and now there's no fish and the seagrass is not in good condition. This change happened after the BP oil spill. Have you studied any of the effects on that specifically?
I'm helping people that are trying to figure out what's going on in Biscayne Bay. And I think Biscayne, it's likely not the BP oil spill. It is likely the fact that there are half the population of Miami-Dade County, they're still on septic tanks, and septic tanks leach phosphorus into the groundwater, and that phosphorus is being carried in groundwater and the canals into Biscayne Bay. So unfortunately, Biscayne Bay looks like a classic case of eutrophication. We've continued to dump phosphorus into the system. It's leaking out into Biscayne Bay, and the seagrasses are dying from the north to the south. So the areas that are closest to the highest population densities are the places that we're losing grass. And the grass is also being lost from the deeper water to the shallower water, which is what you expect if it's just being driven by more and more algae growing in the water and less light transparency. So it looks like it's a pollution, a long-term nutrient pollution that's finally catching up to Biscayne Bay, and it's spreading from the north to the south.
Great.
No, it's not great. It's not great. It's horrible.
Well, great that you could answer the question. Yeah, it's not good news. We are all caught up on our questions. We do have a couple more minutes. Good timing, everyone. If anyone wants to submit questions via Facebook or via Zoom, while we get any final remaining questions, I would love to just know more about how you got into this field. What drew you to working in coastal ecosystems?
Well, I was a kid in the 60s and 70s, so I was raised on the two or three television channels we used to get, and of course Jacques Cousteau was on all the time, and I became fascinated with the ocean. I, by accident, ended up in some really cool places when I was in elementary school and in high school. I spent time in Bermuda and in Florida and developed a love of the ocean, and when I went off to graduate school, went off to undergraduate school, I was taking a class in, it's called the Marine Environments and Organisms. And my professor said, hey, I just got this grant and I need someone that knows how to drive a boat and has their summers free because we need to map seagrass distribution in Florida Bay. So I was sitting in the front because I'm a brown-nosing kind of student. And my hand was right up. I lied through my teeth because I'd never driven a boat in my life, but I did have the summer free. So I was kind of sent down from Virginia to Florida to study these plants that I had barely a grasp of what they were. And that lying in class to my professor started my career that's kept me going for quite a long time.
Awesome. Oh, we do have a couple more questions popping in. Catherine would like to know, do you have any recommendations for which public officials/companies to connect or lobby for better wastewater management? And then also wants to thank you for giving the talk.
It was my pleasure to give the talk. You know, right now there's a newfound appreciation in Tallahassee for the importance of water clarity and water quality that's being dumped out of Lake Okeechobee into the Caloosahatchee and the St. Lucie systems. And right now, I think that this is the place where we need most help. We need the Army Corps to understand that dumping nutrient-laden water out of Lake Okeechobee and shunting it out to tide where it never would have gone in the Caloosahatchee and the St. Lucie is not a thing that they should be doing. Right now, they're limited to doing that because there's lawsuits and environmental and decrees that protect water quality flowing south. And there are also, the Corps is driven by the need to protect life, limb, and property. So they have to, so there's legal requirements for them to do that. There's legal requirements to prevent water quality degradation to the Everglades and further south. So the only option they have right now left is to dump water out of the lake that's full of nutrients that come from north of the lake out into the systems in the Caloosahatchee and the St. Lucie and causing all kinds of problems. So we need central, north central leaders, political leaders in Florida to understand that they have to control nutrient releases off of their farm fields and off and out of the pastures and keep it from going into the lake so that the lake doesn't continue to be this nutrient pool that just is feeding algae blooms on both coasts. So I say, help us fix Lake Okeechobee, and fixing Lake Okeechobee will help fix the coasts of Central Florida on both sides.
All right. Sounds like good advice. We also have a question from Mateo, who said, excuse me, what advice would you give to a marine biologist student who's interested in education and outreach? He is also an advanced certified diver. And also said, thank you for the webinar.
So it's my pleasure again. Mateo, you know, you don't get paid a lot, and there are a lot of people trying to get these jobs. So it's talent and enthusiasm and stick-to-itiveness that gets you a job in the field. You have to bring a unique talent. My unique talent was understanding new ways to look at the availability of nutrients that I learned about when I was a student that had been applied in agriculture, but they hadn't really been applied in the ocean all that much. So that was a thing that I had that separated me from the crowd. So look to bring new skills, new perspectives, and a lot of enthusiasm, volunteer a lot, and eventually the jobs come. Understand chemistry, and hey, do a lot better than I do understanding how to communicate through all the social media that we have right now too. It's important.
That sounds like great advice to end on. Awesome. Well, thank you so much for giving us all of this wonderful information. We had a couple of people ask about where they can find this webinar after. This will automatically save to our Facebook page. So Environment Florida's Facebook, just go to our videos and you can watch this whenever you need. Feel free to keep up to date with us. We're definitely going to keep working to create a healthier coastal ecosystem, save some of our seagrasses, get clearer water. And I want to thank everyone for tuning in tonight. Look out for upcoming oceans events and other events. Thanks so much. And Dr. Forkman, thank you again. This was great.
Thanks for giving me the platform. I really appreciate it.
All right, everyone have a wonderful night, and we hope to see you soon.
Bye.
Bye.